This is Macro Voices with hedge fund manager Eric Townsend, the free weekly financial podcast targeting professional finance, high net worth individuals, family offices, and other sophisticated investors. Macro Voices is all about the brightest minds in the world of finance and macroeconomics telling it like it is, bullish or bearish, no holds barred. Now, here are your hosts, Eric Townsend and Patrick Serezna.
Macro Voices episode 128 was recorded on July 26th, 2018. I'm Eric Townsend. Martin Armstrong, founder of Armstrong Economics, is back as this week's feature interview guest. We'll discuss equity markets, interest rates, inflation, and a heavy dose of geopolitics. Be sure to stay tuned for our post-game segment after the feature interview, when we'll discuss both the short and long-term price outlooks for gold with Santiago Capital founder Brent Johnson.
And I'm Patrick Serezna. Now, Eric, that S&P 500 finally broke out. We legitimately cleared the 2800 level now, and I've printed up to the 2850 area. What's your thinking here on the S&P?
Well, first of all, Patrick, congratulations to you and your members at Big Picture Trading. I know you guys have been making a killing in this market, and you've nailed quite a few calls here. So congratulations on that. I think that we're definitely at the point where it makes so much sense from a seasonality perspective. If you're going to see a summer high, and it's going to be the high for the year, it usually happens in August. Even if it's not going to be the high for the year, there's usually a mid-cycle peak that happens in August, and it seems like we are approaching some kind of top. Maybe we're not quite there yet, but the big question I think that we have to look at, Patrick, if you step back from all of the short-term technical analysis, the big picture technical question is this going to be a failed rally that stops short of the January highs, or is it going to be a double top where we match the same level as the January highs on the S&P, or are we going to go ahead and break out to new all-time highs? That's the really big question that I think is going to give us the tell as to what happens next. As far as the big picture and where we're headed from here, you know, is this a topping pattern, or is that quote from Jeremy Grantham that David Rosenberg had in his slide deck last week where he says, you know, be careful, this is also that time when sometimes you get one last push higher. I generally tend to favor David Rosenberg's case, but let's come back to this in the postgame segment after our feature interview, because I know you put a couple of charts together and I'd like to explore a few other ideas with you.
All right, well, let's move on to the U.S. dollar index, because obviously last week Donald Trump tweets and suddenly we have a U.S. dollar that's throwing back off the 95 level. But after the ECB and Mario Draghi today, we have the U.S. dollar strengthening largely because of weakness in the euro. And once again, it looks like we're going to make an attempt potentially to break out of 95. You think this is going to happen?
I think it will sooner or later. You know, on one hand, the bears are all saying, boy, look at this. Resistance at 95 has proven a real challenge. We're coming up on almost 3 months that the market has been fighting to break through 95, and it hasn't been able to do it yet. Well, that's true. At the same time, for that same period, 94 has been awfully strong support. So this consolidation between 94 and 95, it's almost 3 months long. And, you know, the theory here says that the longer you consolidate, the bigger the move tends to be in either direction after that consolidation. If it's to the upside, which is the case that I am favoring at this point, I think that it's very likely that we'll see an acceleration once we get past this resistance at 95. I think it's probably a pretty smooth shot up towards 100 from there. If you look at, you know, where the last measured move was from 89 or so up to 95, about 6 points, well, that would take you up to 101 if we break through 95. It's not going to happen overnight, but I think that after we have consolidated for 3 months, we're likely to see an accelerated move in one direction or the other. Of course, anything's possible, could go to the downside, but I think the upside is more likely.
All right, well, let's move on to crude oil, and let's start with the inventories. How did everything come in this week?
Well, last week was opposite of the week before, and this week was the opposite of last week once again. Crude oil drawing down 6.1 million barrels, much larger drawdown than was expected. A lot of analysts were expecting about half of that. Cushing, Oklahoma drawing down 1.1 million barrels. Now, that's not as big as it's been in some recent weeks, but still, Cushing is really getting drawn down in terms of absolute inventory levels. It's getting a little bit concerning there. Gasoline drawing down 2.3 million barrels, and distillates drawing down a much smaller 101,000 barrels. So we've got drawdowns across the board. Needless to say, that results in a knee-jerk up in price when the data came out. Curiously, that knee-jerk up was then followed by a knee-jerk back down to the same level, even lower than when the data came out, but very quickly then reversed to the upside. So I'm not quite sure what the uncertainty was, but it eventually resolved to the upside. And then subsequently, we got news about Saudi Arabia ceasing shipments through the Red Sea because they are concerned after having a couple of their tankers attacked. So geopolitical concerns are also helping the price of crude oil on Thursday morning. Frankly, Patrick, the Cushing drawdowns are a bigger concern to me than the size of that big number. Yes, 6.1 million barrels. Wow, that's a really big drawdown. Okay, but it's a really big drawdown in what really is a new era of legalized export. And the fact that we're seeing this continuing trend of large drawdowns on U.S. inventory is a fairly predictable result of a lot of U.S. exports that are continuing to occur. The thing is, Cushing, Oklahoma is landlocked. If they run out of oil in the tanks in Cushing, it creates a real problem. They're not out of oil yet, but they're getting to dangerously low inventory levels, and we're drawing down another million barrels every week. I looked at Genscape numbers this morning, which are predictive of what next week may tell. At least as of Tuesday's measurement, they're still showing further drawdowns in Cushing. So those Cushing numbers are really a concern to me. We'll see what happens in coming weeks.
Okay. What about those time spreads you've been talking about for the recent weeks? Any news developing there?
Yeah, you know, the August to September spread came down to about 60 cents, I think it was, on options expiration day, as we discussed last week. It blew out last Friday to 255. Now, as I said in last week's show, you kind of have to disqualify what happens on the last day because it's thin liquidity and almost anything can happen in terms of price action. But still, you know, to move almost $2 in the course of 3 days, that time spread is really saying there is an alarming problem with a shortage of physical oil in Cushing, Oklahoma, and that's very consistent with this pattern that we've seen of drawdowns. Now, the September to October spread, still, it came down to about $1.03, I think, was the low print on options expiration day. Of course, that was not the option expiring. It was the August option that was expiring. So it got down to just over a dollar. It's been holding above $1.20 for the last several days. And as we're speaking Thursday afternoon, we're looking at $1.19, which is very consistent with the $1.20 or so floor that we've seen for the last few days. So still, we're looking at numbers that are dramatically higher. Now, the question that I've been watching is, okay, what we saw before the August-September contract expired, or the spread expired when the August contract expired last week, was the first two monthly spreads were just crazy. So does that mean that now the next two monthly spreads are crazy, to where it's going to be both September-October and also October-November? No, we're not seeing a contagion there. The real big blowout was August-September and then September-October. October-November is slightly exaggerated, a little bit wider than normal, but nothing extreme. So it seems like whatever the market is concerned with is a short-term situation in Cushing. And again, I don't think the news flow that we've had about Syncrude and Venezuela and so forth really adequately explains this. I think there's more to this than meets the eye. I'm just not sure exactly what that is. In any case, it looks like after we get past the next couple of months, the time spreads are moving back to normal values that are consistent with what you would expect as they reach this proximity to their expiration.
All right, well, let's move on to the bigger picture of oil here, because I just really want to point out that when I look at the Brent contract, that looks truly on a technical basis like the potential topping formation, almost double tops along the high, made a lower low, kind of failed rallies on the right shoulder there. It's like it looks very bearish, but not so much on WTI, but it's still been very weak price action. Do you think this is a bigger topping formation on oil, or what's going on here?
I think it probably is, but I generally have very low directional conviction in the short term. And the reason is just right now the trend is up. But as you've said, there's not a lot of good logical reason to think that the price is going to go above 80 and stay there unless there's a geopolitical upset to bring that about. You know, President Trump really wants lower prices. He's been complaining pretty hard. Russia and Saudi Arabia have shown clear signs that they want to increase production as we start to get to those levels. I don't see a good reason for oil prices to go above $80. Does that mean that they're done here in the low 70s and about to turn back down? I'm not sure. You know, we've got so many things that are changing so quickly and so many situations, geopolitical situations around the world. I could easily see the short term going in either direction. What I don't really see is a good case for why oil would go to $100, say, in the next few months. I just don't see why you would get substantially past $80. Unless, of course, there's a major geopolitical upset. Now, who knows what could be in store with Iran, we might have a major geopolitical upset, but I think that's what it takes to get you substantially past 80. In the meantime, do we turn back down and, you know, go back and test 60 again? Could happen if U.S. production were to continue to pick up, but with all these drawdowns we're seeing in inventory, it's not going to happen right away. So, you know, I think the data is going to tell us. I don't have much directional conviction right now in the short term, other than to say in the intermediate term, I don't see a reason to expect big upside from here.
All right, well, let's move on to gold, because gold seemed to really stabilize down in that 1210 to 1220 area and been holding above there. But this correlation to the Chinese yuan has really been prevalent, and we're not seeing that letting up, and gold just remains sort of stuck in this range sideways here. Where do you think the next move for gold is?
You know, I can make arguments on either side of this. Charles Nenner is an analyst who's done a lot of work on cycles and had a pretty good track record. Long before we got to that level, he had called 1212 as his downside target for gold. And what did we hit that within a dollar or so? I think 1211 and change or 1210 and change was the low print, and that only lasted for a couple of minutes. So, you know, you could say, okay, maybe that was the bottom if Nenner was right on that. I think even Nenner said in his analysis that he would still favor a lower target if the market started to move lower, because he really didn't think it was due to move up until after the summer was over. Meanwhile, I think it really all hinges on the dollar. The only way I see gold making a big recovery here is if the dollar is done, if we see it roll over and decisively break down below 94, and it seems like, okay, 95 really was the top, then maybe, you know, it's time to buy gold, or a little bit past time to buy gold. And what I think is the much more likely case, where the dollar breaks 95 to the upside and probably accelerates from there, I think it means another wave down for gold. I do think the opportunity to buy gold is not too far off here. Probably before this year is out, I wouldn't be surprised if we put in a low, but I don't think we're there yet.
All right, Eric, let's move on to the 10-year Treasury yield, because finally, after 2-3 weeks of us just watching paint dry here, we finally got a breakout in yields. We almost hit 3% on the upside out of that range. Do you think that this breakout is legitimate here?
Well, you know, I suppose on the narrow range, you could say there was a breakout. But really, if you look at the last several months, it seems to me like the wide range, which is the one I care about, is 260 to 3.10. And we clearly haven't broken out of that. There's a narrower range inside of that, which had maybe a low of 280 and a high of 3%. We were lingering along for quite a while on the bottom of that range, around 280, just above 280. Now we're lingering along at the top of that range, just below 3%. So I see us is still inside even the narrow range. We're on the cusp of a breakout of that narrower range, and we'd have to go past 305 and I think past 310 to really confirm a breakout of the big range. Is that where we're headed? Well, time will tell, but I think right now we're still, you know, the last few weeks it's been the low end of inside the range. I think we're at the high end of inside the range now.
Well, thanks, Eric. So now this week's featured interview guest is Martin Armstrong, founder of Armstrong Economics. Eric's interview with Martin is coming up as Macro Voices continues right here at macrovoices.com.
And now with this week's special guest, here's hedge fund manager Eric Townsend.
Joining me next on the program is Martin Armstrong, founder of Armstrong Economics. And Martin, I've really got to hand it to you because last time we had you on the program, a little more than a year ago, S&P was at 2385. And to summarize approximately what you said, look, you could easily make the argument that we're already way overvalued on a fundamental basis, but it doesn't matter. The market could easily double from here. And of course, as much as everybody was calling for a crash at that point, your words were proven quite prescient. It was all uphill from there. Now we've had a few hiccups. Are we finally at the point where maybe we're running out of steam, or do you think that we're going to get past this correction and continue to move higher?
No, this is really a consolidation. And what you have to ask yourself is really, if interest rates are definitely going higher, there's no question about that. And so effectively, you got the bond market going down. You've got people concerned about government on all levels. You have in Europe, I mean, honestly, Italy may end up in a revolution within a couple of years. You have the euro in trouble. You have Brit exit going on. You've got chaos and from Malaysia on. I mean, the safe haven actually is equities. And the amount of money in the bond markets versus equities is, you know, everybody knows it's close to 10 to 1. So all this nonsense about, oh, the stock market's going to crash 50, 60%, you know, that's when it's overbought. You had a real big retail speculative position in there. We don't have that. In fact, you have a lot of the fund managers have been selling the equities, yet, you know, the market keeps going higher. So it's going to be more of an interesting situation where they're kind of flat. And it's like, well, if this thing starts to take off, you're going to have a lot more people rushing back into it. There's certain times in history when the stock market is the problem. And then on the other side of the coin, it's when government's the problem. And that's what we have. I mean, just look around at the states in the U.S. We got Illinois, California, New Jersey. I mean, I moved to Florida. My lawyer basically told me if I died to tell my family to drag my body across the river before they told anybody. It's just taxes are going up crazy. That effectively, the real problem is government doesn't know how to manage even a bubblegum machine. To them, it's always like whenever they need money, well, we just raise taxes. Clearly, they're incapable of managing anything. Otherwise, they would never have to raise taxes, but they constantly always have to raise it. So we're reaching that point. It's really getting quite critical. And you have all these people bashing Trump all the time. But really, it is the Trump revolution. And not that he created something, but you have the 28-year-old Alexandria who won in New York and the Democrat side. Effectively, they were all like, oh, well, maybe the people really want socialism. That's not it. I mean, Trump beat 17 career politicians. She just beat the career politician they thought would be the Speaker of the House. So what you really have going on is people are just fed up with politicians in general. It's a global systemic problem. But we basically have a crisis in political side around the world. You have, you know, Italy throwing out all the career politicians. You have the same thing starting to brew in Britain. It's everywhere. I mean, you had Mexico just overthrow the president down there. He had the same thing in Malaysia. At this stage in the game, it's career politicians have been lying to us since World War II, and they're just fed up with it.
I want to come back to the political subject in just a minute, but I noticed on the equity question, your first and strongest conviction was bond yields are definitely going up, bond prices definitely going down. Let's elaborate on that. Tell us your view on bonds.
It's amazing how people just don't look at history. I mean, if you look at the Dow, all this stuff about, oh, higher interest rates, the stock market should go down. Just look at the data. You'll see that is absolutely false. The Federal Reserve doubled interest rates between 1927 and 1929, and the stock market doubled. In fact, when I did research on that, it was very interesting. The thinking process before socialism was quite different. As long as interest rates were going up, it was viewed as bullish for the stock market because it showed there was still a demand to borrow, which is correct. what is the problem with the ECB and lowering interest rates? They keep going, you know, lower and lower, and they went negative because people were not interested in borrowing. We've done correlations on these things. It's very simple. If you think the stock market will double, you'll pay 10% interest rates. You'll pay 20. If you don't think it's going to go up even 5%, you're not going to pay 5. It has nothing to do with the empirical level of interest rates. It's basically the expectation. Because the stock market has never peaked in history twice with the same level of interest rates. I mean, sometimes it's been 200% as in 1899. And other times, you know, the 1929 was the lowest level of interest rates. So I don't know. It's some sort of thing the talking heads have made up on TV, and everybody repeats it constantly. And they think if you repeat a lie long enough, it just becomes the truth. But it just does not hold up historically with any correlation.
Martin, there's something I want to touch on, which is you have been very quick to say, look, there's a lot of people that are claiming, okay, the stock market's going to crash. There's going to be a horrific crash in the stock market. And you're explaining for very good reason why you don't think that's true. But I've heard you on other occasions make reference to a major monetary crisis at some point in our future being inevitable. And I think maybe people confuse that idea of a monetary crisis with a stock market crash. Please clarify, what is the difference and what do you actually see on the horizon?
Yes, I mean, a monetary crisis is where you're talking about a decline in the currency. For example, the German hyperinflation or something like that, or Zimbabwe. When you get into a crisis like that, all tangible things rise in value because they have an international value to it. And if you look at the currency that Germany issued after the hyperinflation, it was backed by real estate. Real estate will hold up. I mean, gold will hold up. Equities will hold up. These are the things that basically the ones with tangible assets, you have a value to them. So a monetary crisis doesn't mean a stock market crash. It means a basic problem is more on the currency side. And you can have what is typically confused by a lot of people, but you have effectively currency inflation versus inflation from demand. For example, in 1985, I lived in London when the pound went all the way down to 103. And I ran out and I went to British Airways and I asked them how many tickets they would sell me on the Concorde. I mean, they looked at me like I was kind of strange, and they said maximum 25. I said, fine, I'll take them. It was costing $1,000 because the pound went down so far. And a first class ticket on TWA back then was $3,000. You know, I thought it was a great deal. I got on the Concorde, and here it's absolutely full with Americans, and they're all bragging about this is a great deal. Of course, they raised the price after that, and then the pound went back to two. So then it all of a sudden became an $8,000 to $10,000 trip.
So does that mean that you are presently bearish on the U.S. dollar, or is this a longer term view? And what is your outlook for the U.S. dollar?
The U.S. dollar, honestly, it's going nowhere but up. And what you have to understand is what's going on globally. And we have a major, major crisis in Europe. I can't emphasize how bad it really is. They're pushing Italy to effectively triple its inheritance tax. And you have to understand, Italy is more like China when it comes to real estate. Italy has had, before, there was no property tax. All right, so they just put in, you know, like a stamp duty tax in 2017. So now if you want to buy your primary home, you pay basically a 2% sales tax. If you want to buy a second home, it's a 9% sales tax. I mean, that's tremendous on the price. Brussels and the IMF are telling Italy they should triple their inheritance tax because Italy's is 4%. Germany's like 17%. So that's why I say Italy's on the verge of a revolution, because this is where people have saved their money. It's not in the banks. There are people that have multiple houses, etc., and they rent them out just to break even. So you're looking at a real estate crash in Italy that's going to be monumental. And if the banks aren't bad enough now, I mean, this is it. It's pushing everything over the edge. And the politicians just don't get it. They see no end to this taxation. And every revolution has been over taxation. Remember the American Revolution? No taxation without representation. I mean, it's the same thing. So it's just really systemic everywhere. And unfortunately, what Trump doesn't understand is he's still old school in the sense of this idea of trade. And he wants a lower dollar so he can sell more goods overseas. And that's going against them. The dollar is being pushed up because the euro is lucky, really, if it's going to survive past 2021. The pound is seriously in trouble because they still don't understand this whole issue of trade. And it's everywhere you go. I mean, China is going to eventually be the financial capital of the world, but we haven't gotten there yet. They still have, you know, currency controls and things of this nature. So it's not a free currency to be able to invest in or trade yet. Yet it is the third largest bond market in the world.
So where does this go next in terms of the situation in Europe? Because between the refugee crisis, the economic problems, Brexit still pending, the situation in Italy, it seems to me like this can't end well. But I think the big question on investors' minds is, okay, it can't end well, but how does it play out? And how does it play out in markets? Where's the trade? If you see the picture in Europe, you know it's an ugly picture, but you know that's very clear. But less clear is, okay, so what's the trade right now?
Basically, the trade is long dollar, long U.S. assets. You're seeing a lot of major capital starting to pour out of Europe and coming over here. So you have the U.S. fund managers that keep selling the stock market saying, oh, it's overvalued, overvalued. Well, the foreigners are buying it. I mean, you have Draghi coming out and saying, oh, we're going to end the quantitative easing. But he doesn't. There's no way he's going to possibly do that. He's just trying to get out the door next October in 2019. He knows he's created a major crisis. You got pension funds that are going belly up everywhere. I mean, they need 8% to break even. It's the pension crisis that's causing Illinois to go down. And, you know, California wants to put a tax in to cover state employee pensions. It's all just coming to a head. And Draghi realizes what he's done, which is why he's not going to back off of the quantitative easing. He can't. He's really destroyed Europe tremendously because there is no bond market. Nobody's going to buy a bond at even 2% for 10 years. They're just not going to do it. It's been the ECB that's been buying all this stuff up. And he can't stop because there is no private purchase of the bonds. I mean, Japan is kind of in the same boat. I mean, you actually had the central bank brag that they bought 97% of the auction. You think that's good? You're wiping out the free markets. And that's what it was all about. You went to these auctions to basically raise money. Here you got the Bank of Japan and the ECB just printing money just to buy the government debt. You've wiped out the private bond markets on both sides. So how are you going to go back? Our computer is showing that interest rates going up 3, 4, 5 times and very rapidly.
So would you go so far as to say that the trade here is short bonds and long equities?
Well, sure. But I mean, you know, that's another issue with the ECB. I mean, they basically effectively make it almost illegal to short the bonds. I mean, I was in Brussels in meetings and they wanted to take the euro trading away from Britain. To punish them, basically. But also, they think that if the euro starts to get hit, they can just shut down the market and make it illegal to short it, like they do with the bonds. And I asked them, I said, well, are you going to take it away from New York, from Chicago, from Hong Kong, Tokyo, and Shanghai? And they just look at you with a dumb look. Well, no, we were going to take it away from Britain. I said, you're not going to be able to. You're dealing with politicians who have no clue as to the private side, how markets function, or anything of that nature. So I don't know if you're going to be able to short the European bonds. I mean, you may be more on a synthetic, basically, by European equities versus American equities, something along those lines. But that's why the Dow has been going up. And if you look at the Dow, that's what foreign capital goes in there first. The NASDAQ is more of the domestic retail market. S&P will be, you know, professional. But big money from foreign investors, It's like what they do in real estate. I mean, the Japanese came in, they bought Rockefeller Center. They don't go down the street and buy, you know, $150,000 bungalows in a local community. They want the trophies. So that's basically what they do. And they do the same thing in equity. So you'll see that the Dow led all the way up, then it backed off a little bit. I mean, we're still in this consolidation period, and the consolidation can possibly even last into 2020. And if it doesn't, then that's where it's just going to explode, because there's no other place for capital to hide. We've wiped out the government bond markets. I mean, you can go into the corporate, but, you know, I would definitely not go into long term. I mean, we're at 5,000-year lows in interest rates.
Speaking of debt, let's talk about China and the massive credit expansion that has occurred there. A lot of people have said that, you know, someday that bubble's got to burst, and when it does, it could potentially send a shock around the world. What are your thoughts on Chinese markets, particularly credit, but also with respect to their equity market?
They have a problem with the credit side because there wasn't really enough analysis or expertise in even how to manage some of these things. I mean, you have one of the coal companies finally go bankrupt there. But what is different is the central bank is making cash available directly to the companies. That's the way the Federal Reserve was originally designed. And I know you get a lot of conspiracy theories and all this stuff. But the original structure of the Federal Reserve was, yes, it was owned by the banks because it was a bailout fund and they were going to fund themselves. When the Fed was going to look at stimulating the economy, they didn't give the money to the banks. They would buy corporate paper so that if the corporation couldn't get a loan from the banks because the banks were in trouble, then the Fed would lend that money out to the corporations and that would prevent massive unemployment. So that is what is happening in China, which is much better management than we have in the West. What the Fed did and ECB, et cetera, I mean, they just handed banks money and hoped that maybe they would lend it out properly. And they didn't. Then the banks went back and said, gee, we don't make this money. Why don't you create excess reserves? Oh, okay, fine. So all these people were talking about hyperinflation. I mean, it was complete nonsense. Yeah, okay, fine. The Fed created $4 trillion. Then look at the excess reserves. Almost $3 trillion went back sitting there. I mean, it never went into the economy.
Some people are starting to say inflation is about to make a major resurgence. What's your view there?
Yes, but you have to define what kind are you talking about. You have inflation, which can be, most people think of demand inflation, where people are rushing out and buying things. That, not so much. Then you have currency inflation, where the assets rise in proportion to the decline in the purchasing power of the currency. So you have different types of inflation. You can also have inflation that will cause, not necessarily by demand, but by a shortage in supply. So, for example, a major storm happens and wipes out the wheat crop. So all of a sudden, there's a shortage of supply and the price will then rise. So you have different types of inflation. We're definitely looking at more on the side of inflation outside the U.S. Don't forget, as the dollar rises, that creates deflation. So whatever your inflation rate is, you then have to subtract the rise in the dollar. And this is why it's also been very difficult for the Fed to reach its targets. So we've had massive deflation going on, and I can tell you a lot of our banking clients in Europe, I mean, they're not stupid. You're going to have a negative interest rate. So if you're going to have excess funds at the ECB, you're going to have to pay them to hold your money. So quite simply, what they did was they opened up branches in the U.S. They sent money to their U.S. branch, and the U.S. branch basically posted the money at the Fed in excess reserves. You know, they're not stupid. It's just the politicians that are stupid. And the media, basically, I think a lot of them are just journalists that are 23-year-old kids that just put out whatever they're told to put out.
And where do you see on the horizon for gold? We've certainly seen some weakness here. Is it going to continue as the dollar strengthens? Some people think the dollar and gold will eventually decouple. Do you see any truth to that argument, or is the inverse correlation likely to persist?
for the near term. But eventually what will happen is that's when the confidence basically begins to shift. We're not at that point yet. All these people with gold and you know, all the nonsense of hyperinflation and all this stuff. I mean, look, it's been the same argument since 1970, and gold went down for 19 years. That's not the issue. The issue is people will run to gold when they question the validity of government. And that's where the politics come back in. It's a question of your faith in government. And we're seeing such a polarization in the United States. The press is all on the side of basically anti-Trump. So they're really creating this. No matter what he does, it's basically always negative. It's turned into, it really has turned into an unbelievable witch hunt. It's quite dramatic because now my concern is, I mean, I understand why Trump is there. It's the people who basically are fed up with the career politicians. It's not Trump the person. So you really have to wonder what's going to come after Trump. All these people, they're anti-Trump, and a lot of the politicians in Washington I talk, they think if they just get rid of this guy, they'll get it all back to normal. And it's just not going there. They've pushed the envelope way too far, and people are fed up.
Let's stay on that topic of U.S. politics and where they're headed, because we've got midterm elections coming up. And as you've said, you know, it seems to me, Martin, if I think back when I was a kid, I remember as I was a little kid, we had the Nixon-McGovern campaign going on and that whole debate and you know, very heated, a lot of different opinions. We had, you know, Carter-Reagan, lots of very strong opinions in society. But when I was in my 20s and there were a lot of heated debates between my friends and I about politics, nobody thought it was their duty to their country to get a baseball bat and beat somebody's skull in if the other guy disagreed with them. And we've somehow gotten to the point where that's actually happening. I mean, it's isolated in certain incidents. It's not everywhere. But we've got between the extremes, and there are such extremes. As you mentioned, Ocasio-Cortez in New York outright declared socialist. They got the Trump people who are just vehemently behind Trump. And there's even a much more extreme right wing with, you know, people coming out proudly saying that they are Nazis and espousing white supremacy and all of these very, very extreme views. What's driving all of this and where is it headed and where is it going to leave us in terms of being able to, you know, to find a rational government? It seems like everybody's on one extreme or another.
It's basically the socialistic dream we were all sold is falling apart. Forbes has come out. I think it's 65% of kids that graduate can't find a degree in what they have a job in. And then you had the Clintons make student loans non-dischargeable in bankruptcy. I mean, it's just everywhere you look, it's just really bad. I mean, you have even UPS and the Postal Service. Yes, there's jobs available, but only up to 33 hours a week. They won't go to 40 because if they go to 40, then they have to give them pensions. Now, they can't afford the pensions, so they're basically just hiring people up to 33 hours a week. I mean, it's the system is not sustainable. And that's what's causing all this problem if it's elderly. I mean, people are working into their 80s now because they were told to save money, et cetera, for your retirement. They saved and that's it. The value of the house is down. You know, the savings earns nothing in interest. So what do? They have to go out and work. So the whole socialistic dream is gone. And as the pensions continue to decline, I mean, so you have so many groups that are affected different ways, from students to the elderly. And they all have a valid reason. But it's effectively economics that's causing this. And then everybody wants to blame everybody else. I mean, this girl from New York, Alexandria, I mean, she was a waitress, all right? It's okay, but she has no experience and doesn't even understand what she's saying. She was asked a question, well, gee, unemployment is at historic lows under 4% back to the 1960s. And her response was, well, that's only because everybody's working two jobs. Excuse me? She doesn't even understand what she's talking about. And this is the problem. I mean, we're getting into a situation that people are just getting mad. They're just getting violently mad at what's going on. They're lied to all the time. When I go to Asia, I had three governments say, what is wrong with CNN? And I said, what do you mean? He said, you know, they're just bashing Trump all the time. And they said, we think he's doing a great job. He's the first one to ever got North Korea to cross the line. You know, he's at least has everybody talking about trade. And that the difference in this nonsense with trade is that, you know, you can have tariffs, but then they put on duties for everything. So you can pretend it's free trade, and then you try to mail something to somebody, and it's like they're taxed up for crazy just for mailing something to them. I mean, I had a friend, I sent a gift over for Christmas, and they sent back, said, thank you very much. Please don't ever send me anything again. It's just crazy. I mean, when I travel a lot internationally and all the time, they're not looking for trinkets and T-shirts that you bought, you know, and I get pulled over. How much money you got on you? First question. Not just the U.S., Britain even asked me. Took the train from Brussels over to London. I left a meeting in Brussels, so I'm in a suit and tie, and I hopped on the train. Everybody else is in jeans and sneaks, and I'm going to go check into a hotel in London for my meetings over there. I'm the one pulled over. I said, look, I'm an American. That's not good enough. I could be an expat. I had to show them where I bought the ticket, and I had to show them that I had an airline ticket back home from Frankfurt. Then it was okay. I could leave. France stops the train between Switzerland and Luxembourg, searching bags for money. They're just basically all desperate at this stage in the game. I mean, there's a big case going on now that's been on for over a year in Canada. An executive of a will just got a bank check, put it in the mail for $500,000 to the heirs in the United States. It was seized by customs. They said, oh, this is money laundering. It's cash. You can't mail cash. You can wire it, but apparently you can't get a bank check and mail it in. They confiscated $500,000. It's still in the courts.
While we're on this subject of politics, the situation in Russia seems to be escalating. And I was just shocked at not so much the fact that people have different views, but how extreme the views were out of that press conference with Trump and Putin. Literally, senior officials from U.S. government calling for the impeachment and prosecution of the president for treason. It seems to me that, you know, we're dealing with a nuclear superpower, which has recently gone out of its way to show the world through a series of videos that it has hypersonic weapon systems that are capable of overcoming the missile defense capabilities of the United States. I don't think it was an accident that they showed us they've got this stuff. And we continue to see a tremendous amount of very angry rhetoric directed at Russia. Where do you think this is headed, and what are the implications for markets?
It seems, honestly, that there are just people that want war, and that's it. I mean, if you really look at what Putin said, he said, fine, Mueller wants to send people over here or come himself to interrogate the Russians. Please do. He said, no problem. He said, let us do the same thing with the American intelligence people, because I know for a fact that the very reason Putin is in is because there were shenanigans going on, and they got Yeltsin to effectively steal $7 billion from the IMF loans. They steered the wire through Bank of New York, and as soon as that happened, Republic New York went to the National Bank, went to the government, and then said, oh, Bank of New York just did a money laundering. They run into there. And then they basically were trying to blackmail Yeltsin not to run. That's how Putin got in. He realized he was set up, and he wasn't going to put in the patsy that they wanted, Berezovsky. Berezovsky flees to London. He ends up hanging himself, supposedly. Zafra ends up dead. I mean, it's just a mess. You can go online and look at a video, a documentary that's out that was also banned in the United States. It's called The Magnitsky Act, Behind the Scenes. Look, we have been interfering in everybody's elections. We did it with D. to get Drew in New York, I mean, in Canada. We were even caught basically tapping Merkel's phones. Merkel was then caught tapping basically the French. This is standard operational procedure. The way it's being presented here is like, oh, Hillary lost because of the Russians. And they want to effectively just create World War III over this. It's just, it's insane. But this is what they do. I mean, you can look up for just about every war known. Johnson came out on Vietnam. He said, for all he knew, that they were shooting at whales that night. We were never attacked by Vietnam. The Lusitania, the Germans even put in an ad and said, don't sail in the Lusitania because they're using it to sneak weapons into Britain. The weapons of mass destruction. I mean, they haven't told the truth about anything. The Spanish-American War started by Pulitzer and Hearst. I mean, I was taught that in school back then. I don't know. I mean, it's just every war has always been for the benefit of somebody. And it's always some sort of propaganda to get everybody riled up. And I think that's what's going on with Russia. They want a war.
And is there a market implication or a trade angle here, or other than, you know, buy defense stocks? What are the market implications of all of these trends?
Historically, capital tries to move away from wherever the event is. So I think you're probably looking more at the Middle East and not really Asia, but I think it is building up, and the real crisis is going to be with Iran. And you have to understand what is in the Middle East, and that is we're talking about really a religious war between them, the Sunnis and the Shiites. And the difference is that one is that the government should be run by the religion, and the other one is there should be a separation of church and state. And along those lines is what you have Iran versus Saudi Arabia. And they both have different people on their sides, and that's what's happening. Syria, I mean, it's fairly well known. They basically, Qatar wanted to get a pipeline through there to Europe for gas to compete with Russia. So Syria said no, and then Russia comes in to support Syria, of course. I mean, it's economics.
Well, Martin, on that lovely note, we need to wrap it up here. Tell us a little bit more about ArmstrongEconomics.com and what people can find there. And particularly, I know you just recently did one of your conferences, which are extremely popular with the institutional community. I think you just did one in Singapore, and I believe you still got one coming up in Orlando. So tell us what the story is there.
Well, we do absolutely every market around the world. So the computer is always writing reports itself. They're not written by actually individuals, so they're not biased or anything like that. We call it our Socrates system. So it's really the only fully functioning artificial intelligence computer at this level in the world. It's writing research reports on thousands of instruments around the world every day. So we have institutions coming in from everywhere, and these conferences are mainly, we put it all together so you can see what's happening globally. Because, like you said, if there's a war in the Middle East, you'll see capital come rushing into America from even Europe. The only time, you know, when the Cuban Missile Crisis, for example, then the capital left the United States and ran to Europe. World War I, World War II, the capital came here. If you know your history, J.P. Morgan had to bail out the U.S. Treasury back in 1896 because we were bankrupt. So after two world wars, what happens? We end up with 76% of the world gold reserves. And that's what made the dollar the dollar. So it's always capital flows, and war has been one of the major factors in sending capital rushing around the world. So anything in the Middle East, expect the capital become coming in this area, and you're going to see equities rise, the dollar rise, etc. So these conferences, we put everything together so you can see it coming. These things are like a train coming down the track. It's not looking at a forecast of one individual thing because it's all collective. So our forecast on the Dow was correct from 11 on because we were also forecasting the high in gold at the time. So everything is really, it dovetails into one to the other. So that's really how the world economy works. I would say briefly, I've watched it myself over my career when I was in in the early 80s, everybody was in Geneva dealing with the OPEC money. Then all of a sudden, you know, Japan was rising. I went over to Japan. I didn't think I would really know anybody. And all the brokers I knew from Geneva had all moved over there. Then when Japan peaked and that was it, where'd they go then? Then they went to Southeast Asia. So the talent and the capital always shifts. Basically, you got about 4-year trends, and then it shifts again, and then they go, oh, well, let's run over there.
And our listeners can find more about it at armstrongeconomics.com. Martin, I can't thank you enough for a fantastic interview. Patrick Ceresna and I will be back as Macro Voices continues right here at macrovoices.com.
Macro Voices is a listener-driven program. Please email requests for specific future interview guests to requests@macrovoices.com. You can email questions for the program to mailbag@macrovoices.com, and we'll answer them on the air from time to time in our mailbag segment. We also welcome your suggestions for how we can improve the program. Now, back to your hosts, Eric Townsend and Patrick Ceresna.
You know, Eric, what a great interview with Martin. Now, before we get to discussing the interview, we're joined in the post game by Brent Johnson from Santiago Capital. Welcome to the show, Brent.
Thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
All right. Now, Eric, I just wanted to comment quickly on Martin's interview. I thought it was incredibly interesting overall how he has a pretty negative view about how the world is emerging. What did you take away from the interview?
Well, as you say, it kept coming back to politics with a fairly dim outlook. And, you know, I thought about trying to steer the interview in a different direction, but I think he's right that that really is the big issue facing the world. We are in a fourth turning in Howe's generational theory, and it's a time when a lot of stuff is really pretty crazy politically. And I think that's going to continue to be the backdrop behind markets for some time to come. So it was an interesting interview, but I'm looking forward to asking Brent a few questions. Patrick, do you want to kick things off?
Absolutely. Now, Brent, yeah, we invited you to the show because you have some unique views on the long-term bullishness of gold, but you're not a normal gold bull because your perspectives on the U.S. dollar differ dramatically from most gold investors. I mean, you're actually bullish the U.S. dollar. So before we get into gold, please give us your core thesis behind your bullish U.S. dollar view.
Sure. Well, at the heart of it, it's really a dollar short squeeze, for lack of a better word. The demand for the dollar, despite all arguments to the contrary, is still incredibly high. And you get into a situation where dollars are no longer being manufactured, and the ones that are being manufactured, or the ones that exist, are no longer being exported to the rest of the world. So you get into Triffin's dilemma a little bit here, for lack of a better theory. But, you know, at the end of the day, the dollar, for all its flaws, is still the global reserve currency. It is still used for the majority of global trade. It is still used for as the main funding currency. When the emerging markets need to raise debt, a lot of times they do it in dollars, and they've done that in mass. And those dollars need to be paid back in dollars. You know, those loans don't get to be paid back in yen or euros or cotton balls or, you know, Twinkies. They have to be paid back in dollars. And when you have a situation where demand is steady and potentially even rising and supply is falling or at least not increasing, that's a pretty big factor for price to rise. So at the end of the day, it's a dollar short squeeze that I don't think that we can escape.
Brent, I couldn't agree more with that view. We've heard very similar things from Jeff Snyder. But it makes me curious about your short-term view on gold, because obviously we understand, and I happen to agree with you, by the way, in the long term, I'm very bullish on gold as well. But in the short term, it seems to me like dollar going up has to mean gold going down or treading water. Do you still have a bullish view in the short term here, or where do you see in, let's say, the next 6 months to 12 months, where do you think gold is headed?
Sure. So, you know, I've been saying since 2016 that I didn't think gold was ready to break out because of the strong dollar. Attempts since then, but ultimately it's turned back down. You know, again, earlier this year I said, well, I would love to see gold break out. I just didn't think it was ready to do so. And, you know, unfortunately, for those of us in the gold world, we've seen it turn back down pretty hard here in the last 6 weeks. It's turned it down so hard that I think it's due for a bounce. Just about everything I look at says it's completely oversold. Whether you look at the commitment of traders positioning, whether you look at the technicals, well, short-term technicals look bad, but they've kind of hit a key support level. We've had a really bad run for 6 weeks. Usually you get some kind of a relief rally. And it's set up to where we could have a pretty potentially strong relief rally, potentially back up into the 1250 to 1300 range would not be a surprise by any means. But I don't think that we're ready to yet break out to a brand new bull market. So I would expect as we get into 2019, as the dollar bull market starts to take hold, as I believe it will, I think that will provide a headwind for gold. You know, it may not. It really depends on how quickly the dollar starts to do damage to the monetary system. But I think initially the strong dollar is going to be tough for gold. You know, it could trade up, down, sideways for the next 12 to 24 months before ultimately breaking out with gold.
Now, Brent, many gold investors anchor themselves on this idea that gold is being manipulated, and that narrative is something they anchor themselves on. But what further feeds that story is when you see such strong correlations of gold to things like the Japanese yen or the Chinese yuan. What's your take on what's happening here? Is gold manipulated?
Sure. Well, the great thing about conspiracy theories is that there's always enough truth to make it compelling. And I'm of the belief that all markets are manipulated to some extent. I mean, what is the Federal Reserve setting interest rates if it's not manipulation, right? So I think it'd be insanely naive to think that gold is not manipulated in some form. That said, I'm not somebody who thinks that it's been manipulated en masse every day for the last 50 years as part of a global conspiracy. Has it happened? Absolutely. Does it happen? Absolutely. But to think that, you know, governments who can't even manage their own office budgets could manage the gold price for 50 years is a little tough for me to get to. That said, you know, there's no doubt influencing interest rates influences gold. So, you know, when you see things like the correlation of gold with the yuan or correlation with gold with, you know, the yen or even inverse dollar, it is a function of governments acting, and those can have strong influences, and correlations can last for a long time. They can break for a certain amount of time, but ultimately, whether gold is manipulated or whether gold is not manipulated, the manipulation will eventually break. So I think that a lot of the stuff as far as gold being correlated to the yuan recently can really be also attributed to the dollar being strong. The reason that the yuan has been going down is because the dollar's been strong and China has a credit problem. So you can say it's manipulation, or you can just say it's the credit market acting as it always does and as you get to the end of a cycle. So I certainly don't throw stones at anybody who holds the gold manipulation theory. That is part of being in the gold world. You can't get away from it. But I'm also not somebody who comes in every day, and when gold's down, it's because of manipulation.
Brent, you said something a minute ago I want to pick up on. You said at some point you see gold and the dollar decoupling from their inverse correlation and both moving higher together. Now, we've heard that view from a couple of guests, but I think different people have different reasons for holding that view. Why is it that you think at some point we're going to see the dollar and gold, which historically have been inversely correlated, move into a positive correlation where they both go up at the same time?
Well, I guess a long story short, and going back to your comment earlier about, you know, we're in a fourth turning, you know, that book probably influenced my thinking as much as anything. And that's where I think we're at. I think we're at the end of a fourth turning. We're at the end of a debt super cycle. All the debt in the world is a problem. Even the U.S. dollar debt is never going to be paid off. But if you think about Exeter's pyramid and the way it funnels down, and at the bottom of the pyramid is base money and then gold, that really helps explain my dollars and gold theory. As if you understand the way the system is designed and you understand the plumbing of the system and you understand that when debt gets defaulted on, supply of money disappears as well, you get into a situation where it's a short squeeze. And while chaos starts to pick up around the world and we get some of these chaos trades into the dollar, it will also start to leak into gold too. I don't think it will, the first place it will be is go to gold. But as we start to have problems, I think the dollar gets it first. I think dollars and gold get it second. And then ultimately, I think the dollar falls and gold stands all by itself. But it's really kind of a lack of confidence. It's when people start to worry. I think initially when people start to worry overseas, whether that's in Japan, whether it's in Europe, whether it's in China, those flows, I think, will initially go to the dollar. And even if, you know, let's say 80% goes to the dollar and 20% goes to gold, it's still going to go to both, right? And it's not until those problems, you know, have hit Europe, have hit Japan, have hit China, and now they're coming home to the U.S., that I think people will start to leave the dollar and favor gold over the dollar. I think up until that point, they favor both. Or I think initially they favor the dollar, then I think they favor both. And then I think when it finally comes home to roost that the U.S. is, you know, while it may be the cleanest dirty shirt, it's in a hell of a lot of trouble as well, then gold stands alone.
Brent, thanks so much for joining us on the program today. Before we let you go, please tell our listeners your Twitter handle and website so they can follow your work.
Sure. My website is just santiagocapital.com. It's just a landing page, but it has my email and phone number on there. Twitter handle is Santiago AU Fund. I'm happy to communicate with any and all of your guests in whatever manner they seem fit.
Brent, thanks so much for joining us. We really appreciate it. Listeners, we're going to move on now and take a final look at the S&P 500 once more before we close the show up for this week. Please take a look in your research roundup email. You'll find a download link. It says Postgame Chartbook. Go ahead and open that chart up. And on page 2, you'll find the S&P 500. Now, Patrick, I've really got to hand it to you because for your big picture trading clients, you started advising them back in May that it was time to start buying. And a lot of your clients and you were buying in the 2600s. When we had a test of 2700 a few weeks ago, you were very quick to say that you were buying those tests of 2700. And sure enough, your bullish outlook has proven right. So I've got a few comments on this market, but since you've really nailed it so far, why don't you bring us up to date on what you're seeing and where you think it's headed? Or is it over as we're getting to this target breakout zone? Or do you think we're still headed higher?
On this chart, I really tried to identify some of the key overhead resistance zones. I mean, all along, we were anticipating a summer rally that was going to come retest their highs. I'm still open to the idea that we could get this melt-up move in the market, but it's not my favorite scenario. My favorite scenario remains the more David Rosenberg one, which is that this entire year will represent a bigger topping formation. But topping formations don't have to be double tops, and so there's always the chance that the market still makes a higher high, just pokes around here and still messes up. But the one observation I really wanted to make is that while a lot of people are getting very, very excited reaching these upper zones, to me, it's actually, in my mind at least, a diminishing risk-reward proposition in the sense that the easy buying was down in the 2600, 2700, and every 10 points that we're getting closer to the overhead highs, you're risking losing the money that you've made to try I squeeze a little bit more out of the market on the upper end. And so, in fact, into the strength, I'm going to use this as an opportunity to actually lighten up on my positions, and or I'm going to roll up hedges. A lot of times when we take on positions, what we'll do is we'll have some sort of a protective hedge through options. And so a lot of times when we hit our upper targets, if you don't want to give up the position and just get out, a lot of times you can just forfeit some returns, buy and lock in those gains on the advance, and still leave the market open for further gains. And the key thing here is that as we reach these upper zones, I'm more excited about profit taking than I am about engaging the market with a new long trade.
I just want to make sure that we explain that concept for anyone who's not familiar with it. When you're using a protective hedge, you've got a put option that has a strike price lower than the market. And the technique is, as you are proven right and the market moves higher and your long position is profiting, you close that low strike option and you replace it with an option which is what, either closer to the market or at the market. And that basically allows you to decrease the deductible in the insurance policy to make the analogy work. What you're doing is you're limiting your downside and you're capturing the profits that you have so that if the market tanks, you're protected from a higher level. And I know that's one of the techniques that you teach at Big Picture Trading. So I just want to make sure that we explained what you meant when you say rolling up hedges. Sorry for the interrupt. Please continue.
No, absolutely. And just to add to that, there are other techniques. One alternative, of course, is to be rolling up call options. And as you're building intrinsic value in the call options on the upside, you can be rolling up the strike on the calls and extracting intrinsic value. I mean, they're synthetically the same type of a strategy. It's just one, you're doing it with the equity and rolling the hedge, while on the alternative, you're just rolling the call higher and higher as you're going. It's a game of knowing what you're aggregate delta exposure is on your option positions. Bottom line, though, just on this chart, I just want to share is that I'm looking for this market to bump its head. Now, that doesn't mean that when it bumps its head along its previous highs, that that's the end of it. I mean, a lot of times things will just stall, consolidate there, and then they'll still pivot to all-time new highs. So by no means am I trying to already say this is the big one. But I'm watching this overhead resistance and how the market behaves as we approach it.
I think we should mention, too, from a seasonality perspective, things are lining up just about as you would expect them to. Normally, if you're going to have a crash year where everything falls apart in October, which we don't know that that would happen, but it's a possibility. If you're going to have that, usually it's sometime in August that you hit the high, then the volatility picks up in September, and it really gets ugly in October. So, you know, the fact that we seem to be approaching some kind of an interim high here, from a seasonality perspective, that will occur in August sometime. It just fits into the overall program. And I think from a big picture standpoint, you know, it seems to me like what we're looking at here, my base case, like you're saying, is this is some kind of topping pattern. Doesn't mean the high is in, though. You know, that January high could have been the left shoulder in a head and shoulders pattern. Maybe we're going to go up to 3,000 on the head and come back down to the 2,600 level and go back up and you know, form a head and shoulders. Who knows? But I think it's most likely some form of topping pattern. The thing I can't get out of my head is that quote that David Rosenberg had in his chart book from Jeremy Grantham, where he says, you know, it really seems like the smartest guys in the room can see that this thing ought to be over here. But boy, that's when markets sometimes fool you and you get that one last crazy bullish move higher that doesn't make any sense, and all the smartest guys in the room are shaking their heads, but the market still moves higher. Now, as Martin Armstrong said in today's interview, usually the reason that happens is retail euphoria. The professionals know that it's reached an end, but it's the over-enthusiastic, over-exuberant retail investor who takes it that extra last push. And I think, as Martin Armstrong pointed out, we don't really have that kind of retail participation in this market. And that's what leads me more to favor the case that David Rosenberg is favoring, that probably we're in some kind of topping pattern. I guess my question to you is, at what point would you decide, hey, it's not a topping pattern, we are going to see another wave higher, a last final hurrah before the bull market is over? What signals would you be watching for to tell you that it's more than just a topping pattern that we're looking at here?
You know, I think that what I'm going to be looking for is actually not so much the technical levels, but actually what happens to the generals of the bull market. Now, obviously, we've now just seen what happened to Facebook on its earnings with a monstrous 25% drop and just completely derailing the entire bull advance there. But while we're recording here, we still have not yet seen the earnings from the two big tech behemoths of Amazon and Apple. And if we were to see another substantial leg higher, my view would be that the earnings should be well received in those, and we should see almost like a Google style off to the races. And if those leaders are going, it's going to allow the market to get tailwind and potentially do that kind of big breakout. But boy, if Amazon had a disappoint and Apple didn't get any traction on the upside whatsoever, then suddenly one general after another are falling, and it's going to be hard pressed to see how the market is going to get any traction to really push in a big way on the upside. And that's not technical levels. It's going to be really about seeing how these earnings play out on some of these big behemoths.
Well, needless to say, Facebook didn't start that particular trend in a very good direction, if they're any indication. But we'll have to wait and see how the others work out. Meanwhile, we're going to leave it there, folks, but we need your help promoting the show. So please tell your friends and colleagues about Macro Voices, retweet us, forward your research roundup emails, and most importantly, register your free account at macrovoices.com, because the more registered users we have, the more able Patrick is to negotiate to get the very best feature interview guests on the program. The benefit to you is you'll receive our free research roundup email each week, which never contains any advertising or marketing. It's just a compendium of links to all of the coolest stuff that we could find on the internet, including supporting materials for our own content here on Macro Voices. Patrick, tell them what they can expect to find in this week's research roundup.
All right. Well, this week, you're going to find the transcript for today's interview with Martin Armstrong. You'll also find the link to that S&P chart that me and you just discussed earlier. There's also a link to Dr. Lacey Hunt's Hoisington second quarter review and outlook, which I thought was really interesting. There's also a great article from Kevin Muir from the Macro Tourist on the Japanese tightening is a pipe dream. And there's also a Saxo Bank article on the China's yuan maintains a stranglehold on gold. gold. So you'll find this and so much more in this week's Research Roundup. That does it for this week's episode. We appreciate all the feedback and support we get from our listeners, and we're always looking for suggestions on how we can make the program even better. Now, for those of our listeners that write or blog about the markets and would like to share that content with our listeners, send us an email at researchroundup@macrovoices.com or tag it with the MVRR hashtag on Twitter, and we'll include it in our weekly distributions. If you have not already, follow our main Twitter account at Macro Voices for all the most recent updates and releases. You can also follow Eric on Twitter at Eric S. Townsend and myself at Patrick Serezna. On behalf of Eric Townsend and myself, thank you for listening, and we'll see you all next week.
That concludes this edition of Macro Voices. Be sure to tune in each week to hear feature interviews with the brightest minds in finance and macroeconomics. Macro Voices is made possible by sponsorship from BigPictureTrading.com, the Internet's premier source of online education for traders. Please visit BigPictureTrading.com for more information. Please register your free account at MacroVoices.com. Once registered, you'll receive our free weekly Research Roundup email containing links to supporting documents from our featured guests and the very best free financial content our volunteer research team could find on the Internet each week. You'll also gain access to our free listener discussion forums and research library. And the more registered users we have, the more we'll be able to recruit high-profile feature interview guests for future programs. So please register your free account today at macrovoices.com if you haven't already. You can subscribe to Macro Voices on iTunes to have Macro Voices automatically delivered to your mobile device each week free of charge. You can email questions for the program to mailbag@macrovoices.com, and we'll answer your questions on the air from time to time in our mailbag segment. Macro Voices is presented for informational and entertainment purposes only. The information presented on Macro Voices should not be construed as investment advice. Always consult a licensed investment professional before making investment decisions. The views and opinions expressed on Macro Voices are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect those of the show's hosts or sponsors. Macro Voices, its producers, sponsors, and hosts Eric Townsend and Patrick Serezna shall not be liable for losses resulting from investment decisions based on information or viewpoints presented on Macro Voices. Macro Voices is made possible by sponsorship from BigPictureTrading.com and by funding from Fourth Turning Capital Management, LLC. For more information, visit MacroVoices.com.